Dr. Rahayu and Dr. Fairuz and fellow colleagues.
Okay, boleh.
Ya, doktor. Okay. So, saya akan share pasal advanced trauma life support lah. Supervised by Dr. Rahayu.
So, what is trauma? Trauma is in to body or disruption of the bodily function by physical agent lah. So, when trauma patient datang, so kita punya goals untuk management trauma patient, first kita kena identify and treat the threats of life. Lepas tu baru kita pergi to the respective anatomy and then prevent exacerbation of existing injuries or occurrence of any additional injuries lah. And also return the patient to a level of function as close to pre-injury as possible. Next is the principle of management of trauma patient. Treat the greatest threat to life first and differentiate diagnosis is not immediately important. Time very matters. Do no further harm. Kita assess patient, kita intervene and then always reassess back the patient. So approach the trauma patient, kita ada first triage, primary survey including ABCDE, resuscitation and stabilization, secondary survey, re-evaluation, definitive care. Definitive care tu maksudnya bila kita dah assess semua, dah stabilize patient, kita tahu mana fracture ataupun ada intra-air ke, baru kita refer lah respective department. Selalu kalau trauma ni either ortho, surgical, kalau ada facial trauma, ada dental or ENT ataupun oftal lah. So kalau triage, first kali patient datang, selalunya kalau kat hospital setting, MA dekat depan lah yang akan triage patient, sama ada patient stable, boleh pergi green ataupun kalau macam on stretcher, on pakai collar, ada multiple splint, so kita masuk tolak masuk yellow zone lah. So next is a primary survey. Comprises the ABCDs of trauma care and also identifies life-threatening condition. So, masa kita proceed dengan ABCDE ni, sambil-sambil tu kita kena identify the life-threatening condition of this patient lah. Kita kena exclude benda tu. And then kalau kita detect, kita kena treat.
So, these life-threatening conditions must be diagnosed and treated immediately. So first is the A. A means airway maintenance with restriction of the cervical spine motion. So always assume that patient kalau trauma always ada cervical spine injury. So kita kena maintain the head to neutral position, maintain inline stabilization, also correct size collar application lah. Kalau collar tu besar sangat, kita adjust bagi dia betul-betul fit dengan patient. So how to assess the airway? First sekali kalau patient datang, selalunya kita akan tanya nama patient lah. So kalau patient boleh jawab nama dia siapa, so means kita boleh exclude any airway obstruction, means airway dia pattern sebab dia boleh bercakap dengan tanpa ada SOB ke apa ke. Airway assessment, benda-benda yang tu, and then kita can, boleh tengok vital sign dia, respiratory rate, SpO2 monitoring dia, and then detect the airway patency, and kita dengar any, kita tengok any ada secretion from patient mouth ataupun kita dengar patient ada strider. Look any traumatic injury over the clavicle and also assess the ventilation status lah. Tengok patient ada wheezes ke ataupun dia tachypneic using of accessory muscle. So during the kita assess dia punya airway dia, so kita kena exclude dua life-threatening condition lah. First is airway obstruction. So if the patient came dan kita dengar patient snoring, gurgling or stridor, patient ada hoarseness of voice, patient become hypoxic, SpO2 less than 95, use of accessory muscle ataupun patient became blue lah, tapi bila cyanosis ni selalu late presentation. So what we can do, if kita suspect ada secretion or blood coming from her, kita boleh buat suction and also remove all the debris. Kalau ada mechanical blockage, contoh gigi patah, tersekat ke apa, kita boleh buat finger sweep and removal of the object. Partial airway obstruction, kita boleh buat jaw thrust. In trauma patient, selalu kena buat jaw thrust sebab kita always suspect patient ada cervical injury. Kalau pitang, kita boleh guna oral pharyngeal airway, also back mouth mask. If patient ada maxillofacial facial injury, we can either attempt reduction, tapi ni selalu by primary definitive treat team, or kita boleh intubate terus lah. If cannot intubate and cannot ventilate, kita boleh choose to do cricothyroidectomy. Second is tracheobronchial tree injury. Ni bila kita suspect ni, bila kita suspect ada blunt or penetrating neck injury, patient trauma, tiba-tiba ada hemoptysis, ada cervical subcutaneous emphysema, cyanosis, tension pneumothorax, incomplete chest expansion. So how to treat? Kita kena intubate patient. And then if the suspect patient ada pneumothorax, insert chest tube. Selective intubation of unaffected bronchus may be required. Selective intubation ni maksudnya kita intubate, tapi ETT tu masuk dekat bronchus yang patent. So kita deeper the ETT
2 to 4 centimeter macam tu. And so then if kita suspect ada tracheal bronchitis injury, immediate operative intervention lah. So kita boleh refer cardiothoracic department kalau ada lah. So this is the example of the definitive airway. Sorry, the airway. First is the intubation. Kita boleh intubate patient RSI lah, rapid sequence intubation yang 7 piece tu. And then the second gambar is the oropharyngeal. Third, yang gambar tu yang ada glove warna biru tu adalah cricothyroidotomy. And then yang bawah tu adalah laryngeal mass airway. Okay, next is breathing and ventilation. So B, kita patient datang lepas kita assess kira kita clear the airway, so kita move to breathing. So how to recognize any breathing problem? Macam biasa, inspection of patient, percussion of patient. First, patient sampai, kita inspect dia punya respiratory rate. Kalau kita nampak patient lagi tak. Ni chest deformity. Atau any other paradox chest movement. Next is palpation lah, any tenderness dekat chest, what the what kita buat, kita selalu kita buat chest spring dekat patient, and then incussion either down right hyper. We hear the breath sound and also equality of the air entry. So in breathing and ventilation, kita kena exclude dua life-threatening condition. The first one is attention pneumothorax. This is based on the clinical diagnosis lah. Patient trauma datang in respiratory distress. Kita noted dia punya trachea dia deviate to the opposite side. Ada distended night vein. Reduced chest expansion on the affected side. Hyperresonance on percussion of the affected side. Absent breath sound on the affected side. If ada ultrasound, kita boleh perform extended fast scan lah. Kita nampak absent sinus sliding sound. So, once kita note patient attention number 3, so kita kena buat either needle thoracoscopy ataupun chest tube insertion. So, number 2, kita kena exclude open pneumothorax. Biasa kalau kita boleh suspect open pneumothorax bila kita expose patient chest wall, nampak ada open wound lah dekat chest. So, open wound tu mesti more than 2/3 diameter of the trachea. And also patient is in respiratory distress, decreased breath sound, also noisy movement of air via chest wall injury. So what we can do in patient with open pneumothorax, kita boleh buat occlusive dressing lah. Selalu kita pakai gauze punya plastik tu untuk buat occlusive dressing. Okay. So this is the position kalau buat chest tube lah, kita panggil safety triangle. Base of axilla, lateral edge of lateral metrosi, fifth intercostal space dengan lateral edge of pectoris major. So kita insert chest tube dekat tengah-tengah tu. Okay. So C, after kita secure airway and breathing, so kita move to circulation. C means circulation with hemorrhage control. So kalau C ni kita boleh anticipate patient either can be stable ataupun be in shock lah. So shock impact tissue perfusion, where tissue oxygenation is inadequate to meet the metabolic demand. Prolonged shock state leads to multi-organ system failure and also cell death. So biasa kalau trauma case, kita boleh suspect 3 type of shock lah. Hemorrhagic shock, obstructive dengan neurogenic. Hemorrhagic, the assumed hemorrhagic shock in all trauma patient until proven otherwise may result from internal or external bleeding. Second is obstructive shock lah. If patient contoh tension pneumothorax tadi, and also if patient ada cardiac tamponade, and also patient trauma yang ada spine fracture yang ada spinal cord injury, kita boleh suspect neurogenic shock. So clinical sign of shock. Kita boleh tengok based on patient punya mental status, heart rate, patient will become tachy, arterial hypertension, systolic blood pressure less than 120, and also inadequate tissue perfusion, pale skin color, cold, calmy skin, delayed capillary returns, lepas tu decrease urine output ni kalau kita dah insert CBD lah. Selalu kalau kita tulis dekat clerking tu kan, alert, conscious, lepas tu good pulse volume. CRT last into second, one preference, some ni lah in tissue perfusion, 4 classes lah. Class 1, class 2, class 3, class 4. Depends on the blood loss. Patient tachy or brady, tachy or normal heart rate, blood pressure normal ataupun hypotension. Respiratory rate dia, tachypnea ataupun normal. Urine output dia normal ataupun reduced ataupun anuria.
and also dia punya mental status dia. So kalau class 1 tengok blood loss up to 15% of the blood volume, blood pressure however still normal, pulse pressure also good, respiratory rate 14 to 20 within normal range, rate output still good. Ini kalau kita dah insert dia punya CBD, and also patient slightly anxious lah tapi still alert. Kalau class 2 dia punya blood loss dia banyak sikit, 750 ke 1.5 liter, and then the blood pressure still in normal range. And also dia punya mental status dia mildly anxious lah, maybe become restless sikit lah. And blood loss, so patient will become more tachycardia, and also blood pressure become more hypertensive, and also patient will become more restless, and so on class 4 juga. So if masa C ni, so kita management kita insert tu large IV lah, kalau patient sampai dia punya vital sign dia not good lah, hypotensi, tachycardia, so kita masuk tu large bronula, and then attach cardiac monitoring, blood pressure monitoring, identify any hemorrhage, apply direct pressure. Contoh kalau patient ada intra-abdominal injury, penetrating injury, so either blood gushing from the abdomen, so kita apply direct pressure, or patient ada long bone fracture, open femur fracture, ada oozing ataupun active bleeding, so kita buat compression bandage, and also restore circulating volume, which kita resus patient lah, either by venous line, Hartman ke atau jela ke, ataupun kita can blood transfusion, and also immobilized fracture if patient ada long bone any fracture. So in circulation, kita kena exclude dua ni. First, massive hemothorax. Massive hemothorax bila kita assess patient, diagnosis of percussion, absent breast sound. So massive hemothorax, how to define, is defined as bila kita insert chest tube, ada rapid accumulation of more than 1.5 liter of fluid lah, or 200 ml per hour in the first 2 to 4 hours. So immediate treatment of massive hemothorax, kita kena insert chest tube and also thoracotomy, and also kita kena transfuse blood lah if patient memang not stable. So next is cardiac tamponade. How to diagnose? Back striate lah, muffle heart sound, hypotension, also distended night vein. So patient ada small sign positive. Kita buat fast scan, noted ada pericardial effusion. So what to do? We can do pericardial synthesis or open thoracotomy. Next is traumatic circulatory arrest. So kalau kita dah exclude massive pneumothorax dengan cardiac tamponade, tapi patient still ada become hypotensive, tachycardia, so kita kena exclude lah traumatic circulatory arrest. Contoh patient severe hypoxia, tension pneumon, profound hypovolemia, severe myocardial contusion, so kita kena treat accordingly. So after ABC, kita pergi dilah disability. So disability or dysfunction of CNS, baru kita assess lah, dah stabilize semua dia punya vital sign, BP semua, and kita assess pupil size and rest point, assess the GCS, AVPU, alert, respond to verbal, V, respond to verbal stimuli, P, respond to painful, U is unresponsive. And kalau kita suspect patient under neurogenic shock ke, kita can buat motor ancestry exam lah, either normal gastro session or not. Okay, and then exposure and environmental control. So ni baru kita dah settle semua, baru kita remove all the clothing and kita start buat lock roll lah. Remove all clothing, examine any signs of injury. Lock roll the patient to examine patient's back. First, biasanya kita buat empat orang lah. Seorang akan maintain the cervical immobilization. Lepas tu, so dua orang akan tarik badan, tolak badan patient ke tepi. Seorang akan buat the examination. So kita palpate along the thoracic, lumbar spine. Do rectal examination, kita check for anatomy. Also kalau ada dah pasang CBD, kita boleh buat VCR. And also avoid hypothermia. After you remove all the clothing, kita apply warm blanket after removal of clothes. So this is the gambar orang buat lock roll lah. Okay. So adjunct to primary survey and resuscitation. So kita boleh insert CBD to monitor the ring output. Tapi kita kena withhold if there is evidence of uterine injury lah. Contoh kalau kita nak masuk CBD tu, kita nampak dekat uterine meatus ada blood, ada perineal hematoma ataupun masih 2 PR tu ada hyoidine prostate, so kita suspect uterine injury, so no need to insert the CBD. Rise tube to prevent gastric dilatation. Kalau patient ada facial fracture, masuk rise tube ikut mulut lah, jangan masuk ikut hidung. And then all the bloods lah, ABG, FBC, electrolyte, glucose, semua tu. And then fast scan also radiograph.
So kalau in trauma, fast scan focus assessment by sonography in trauma. So kita look for fluid in four areas. The first is hepatorenal, second splenorenal, third pelvic and so forth pericardial space. So kalau kita buat fast scan tu, in trauma patient assume kalau ada fluid represent blood lah, and fast scan can detect 200cc blood or more. Radiograph, after kita dah settle semua, baru kita proceed dengan imaging. Contoh patient kita suspect rib fracture ke apa ke, kita buat chest x-ray, suspect pelvic fracture and any lumbar okay. fracture, so kita buat x-ray. Okay. Hello, doktor. Doktor Ayu, nak tambah ke?
Line tak apa-apa elok kot.
Oh,
okay. Saya nak cakap apa eh? Okay, so I think yang slide pasal classes of shock tu is quite important lah. Nah, it's important because you need to be able to recognize patient is in which class of shock, because that will determine what sort of fluid that you will need to give to patient. Say if patient in class 1, patient may or may not need resuscitative fluid. And if you nak start resuscitation, you may start with crystalloid. Kalau patient tu you dah identify dia dalam class 2, patient may need to start dengan colloid apa semualah. Tapi by the time dia dah class 3 or 4, nak tak nak you need to start with blood product. Class 3 tu patient, you know, you should be ordering saline cross match already lah. And kalau blood class 4 tu patutnya dah safe O lah. Nah, so that's why you need to recognize patient in which class of shock. Yang kedua, with regards to this table, it's only applicable in young patient yang tak ada medical illness. It doesn't work for patient at extreme of ages, maksudnya elderly or pediatric. So this table is basically untuk orang dewasa yang tidak ada medical illness. Because once dah jadi elderly and ada comorbid, sometimes they are complicated by polypharmacy. You know, once patient to say patient to on beta blocker, you know, you're not gonna get tachycardia dah. You know, your beta blocker will mask your tachycardia. So be careful in your interpretation of trauma patient on the background. Sama juga kalau patient tu patient pediatric. You know, their response wouldn't be following these classes of shock lah. So your index of suspicion kena lebih ni lah. So bukanlah nak kata table ni tak berguna, tapi it's useful for a certain group of population. Tapi it's not really applicable untuk semua jenis patient lah. So in certain special groups, you need to be more alert lah. Okay. Satu lagi yang pasal yang masa mula-mula, masa kat breathing tu kan, open pneumothorax tu, Nida cakap occlusive dressing. Tapi just nak clearkan sikit, ha, occlusive dressing ni, perasan tak apa yang special about the occlusive dressing tu? Kalau tengok gambar tu, ni dia pakai tip warna oren lagi. Tapi what so special about the occlusive dressing? Is it just occlusive dressing per se, ke ada anything special about the occlusive dressing that you notice? Ni dia pakai macam some sort of aluminium foil lah. Nida tadi cakap pakai plastik gauze tu kan. But what is special about the occlusive dressing tu? Dalam gambar
ni yang special lah.
Nah, apa yang special pasal occlusive dressing ni? I mean, what's so special about the occlusive dressing for open pneumothorax?
Okay, to make one way entry saja.
Yelah, what's so special? Nama penuh dia bukan occlusive dressing sahaja. Dia ada nama sikit depan dia tu lagi.
Oh.
Anyone? Dalam gambar ni pun dia dah tunjuk. Saya berharap semua orang akan pick up lah. Sebab just jangan ingat occlusive dressing saja. Just nak make sure everybody's clear on the occlusive dressing. Nama penuh dia adalah three-way occlusive dressing. Perasan tak? Dia tutup tiga side sahaja. So dia kena cakap three-way occlusive tiga dressing side. Because takut ada orang salah faham, occlusive dressing dia tape all the four sides. Dia three-way occlusive dressing. Dia kena one of the sides kena buka. Dalam gambar pun tunjukkan dia tape tiga je. Bukan gambar ni tak siap lagi. Gambar ni nak tunjuk bahawa dia take tiga je. And one side you allow it to open so that it creates a one way valve. So that benda ni is gonna go into physiology of open pneumothorax. So open sucking chest wound lah. Tapi tu kalau nak cerita hari ni panjang lagi lah cerita dia. Ha. So if anyone interested bolehlah approach saya PM tepi ke have another session ke. Nah, you know, kadang-kadang saya suka tanya untuk soalan CBD or CEX. So okay, any other questions? Okay, dah habis belum lagi kan?
Doktor nak belum dah. Doktor Ayu tadi nak tambah tadi.
Itulah saya pun Doktor Ayu macam nak tambah apa. Saya rasa dia tengah cari line yang elok sikit kot. Dr. Rahayu tengah mengembara cari line tu. Tak ada suara kat you.
Okay, boleh ingat lah. Saya nak tambah lah, saya tak pasti yang ni Dr. Fairuz lah komen ataupun tak komen lagi, tak tahulah kan.
So, mungkin tak kot.
Boleh Dr.
Tak dapat line. Regarding the pelvic lock roll. Ha, dulu kalau dalam primary survey kita cepat kan buat lock roll kan. Untuk patient-patient yang tu trauma. Tapi sekarang ni yang latest punya dia kata kita kena rule out dulu pelvic injury. You rule out dulu pelvic injury baru lock roll. Sebab dia takut daripada unstable pelvic injury yang stable jadi unstable. Dia jadi lagi worsen the condition. So maksudnya kalau you rasa patient tu unstable memang due to the ada problem, maybe ada bleeding kat belakang apa semua tu, you kena secure dia punya bleeding baru you start lock roll the patient. Selalunya dia suruh delay kan sikit lock roll tu. Yang terbaik buat in trauma patient sebab sekarang mereka lebih go to the pelvic palpation. Palpate aja. So dulu pun kalau kita buat pelvic spring pun kita tak buat apa, kita tak buat untuk apa banyak kali tu tak. Sebab kata you ada pelvic injury, sekejap lagi orang ni tekan. Lepas tu dia ada person tekan. So dia akan lagi worsen the condition kan. So kalau kita discussion, dia berpik advice kepada pelvic palpation. The other one is about the cervical, CT cervical. Saya selalunya kalau patient-patient yang GCS okay, walaupun you buat CT brain, saya tak proceed dengan CT cervical. X-ray cervical yes saya buat. Kecuali patient tu memang clinically rasa dia ada neck tenderness, dia ada numbness kat hand, bilateral hand, so you ada rasa most probably patient ni maybe ada cervical injury baru you proceed. Kalau GCS elok lah, you boleh assess. Kalau nak you buat X-ray cervical. Okay. Lepas perkenaan dengan transfusion. Okay, kalau blood, you ambil blood. Blood, kena the one person kalau dia handle untuk BJSM dia saja. Dan kalau you ambil blood, kita letak mata-mata sebab nanti kita takut akan jadi transmission. Yang tu so you kena memang handle trauma patient, dia ada kena betul-betul tekankan lah. Okay?
Okay.
Itu saja. Saya kan kalau kata yang ni dah di komen tak apalah kan. Sebab saya baru dapat time. Okay.
Okay. Proceed with that. Okay, so dah habis primary survey, kita dah research 13 patient. So baru kita proceed dengan secondary survey. So begins one primary survey completed, resuscitative efforts established and also normalized of the vital function. So masa secondary survey ni baru kita buat head to toe examination. Take the ample history, A, allergies and medication, P, past illness or patient pregnant ketat, L is last meal, E is events or environment relating to injury, and also physical examination, reassessment of all vital organs. So masa secondary survey ni baru kita buat focus physical examination. So head and skull kita inspect any trauma, and also any ada kita sign vital sign, ada basal skull fracture ataupun noted ada CSF leakage dekat nose ke. Next, tengok balik lah, kita assess balik daripada head to toe. So chest, tengok ada full chest, irregular paradiscal breathing pattern. Kalau abdomen, check angle posture abdomen, tengok ada pelvic tenderness ataupun instability. Lepas tu perineum, rectum, vagina, tengok kalau retro breathing, means ada retro tear ke, identify retro toe ataupun tengok ada blood in the vagina ball. So after all of this, kita always have to reassess patient lah. So reassess patient vital sign. Kalau kita tengah research patient dengan fluids, kita kena tengok clinical response to fluids. Cukup ke tak volume of fluid kita bagi. And also determine whether antibiotic and tetanus prophylaxis are warranted lah. So kalau open fracture, kita bagilah ATT ataupun antibiotic, cover antibiotic. So after the patient dah, kita dah bagi semua, reassess semua, patient is stable, baru kita refer to the respective department lah. And then take home message, there is no eye in trauma. Trauma is best managed by a team approach. Primary survey, kita evaluate the physiology. Secondary survey, baru kita evaluate the anatomy. That's all from you. Thank you.
Okay, ada soalan ke untuk Nida? Dari kawan-kawan? Okay, it's interesting lah conclusion Nida tadi. There's no I in trauma kan? Yeah. Adakah I? Tak ada I dalam trauma kan?
Tak ada I.
So, and it's team-based approach. Dan bila kita kata team-based approach in trauma management ni, dia bukan merujuk kepada team ED sahaja. Bukan kata ED kena manage trauma as a team. Dia in polytrauma or major trauma, team approach ni merujuk kepada team surgical, team NS, team auto, meaning that trauma team. Dia, once you identify patient having major trauma, sepatutnya this team should be activated early, because you know the earlier everybody get together, the earlier you can decide whether this patient needs to go for CT ke, or this patient needs to go to OT ke, or whatever, because that's what it meant sebenarnya. Tapi kita kat Malaysia ni masih, you know, step by step by step, which sometimes can delay management. Dia by right, once you identify polytrauma patient, get everybody to come down. Sebab then they can give their input whether they want patient to go for CT first or whether this patient is unstable, and they can decide whether this patient is going to OT immediately lah. These are something that kita masih dalam proses untuk improve, because it's difficult to change traditional punya cara management kan. So hopefully bila zaman korang dah besar, dah, you know, jadi specialist, dah jadi consultant apa semua, this thing dah berubah lah. Sebab, you know, you see every day lah kan. Kalau call awal sangat, kata apasal awal sangat, tak buat apa-apa lagi. Call lambat sangat, kenapa call lambat sangat? You know, it's very difficult to get the just the right time untuk refer kan. There's no right time to refer. Sebenarnya once you dah identify trauma patient, polytrauma or major trauma, all the team should be activated supaya management tu lebih streamline dan lebih efficient. Bukan kata ED duduk main sejam, dua jam, ED pun dah macam dah tak tahu nak buat apa lah. Barulah call, then surgical baru datang sejam, dua jam pula lepas tu. Lepas tu nak decide, you know. Kalau perasan kita punya trauma management takes ages and ages kan. Tu belum kira CT rosak ke apa semua lagi. Oh, tunggu RTK dan sebagainya sekarang. It take ages. Patient kadang pukul 8 nak sampai decision nak masuk OT ke nak pergi CT tu kadang petang baru dapat, which is not efficient. So we need to, you know, koranglah generasi baru yang diberi didikan ilmu supaya later boleh mengubah this paradigm that we're having now. Faham? Okay. Sebab tu kita duk ajar benda-benda ni. Okay. Ada any other questions? Okay. Itu bebelan lah. Luahan hati.
Ada soalan ke?
Tak ada. Saya tak ada lah. Dr. Rahayu, ada nak cakap apa-apa lagi? Ada nak tambah?
Okay, aku. Dr. Sairu pun dah tambah banyak lah.
Okay. Tak ada apalah. Saya okey je. Terima kasih Nida dan Hadirah for the presentation.
Thank you Dr. Rahayu dan Dr. Fairuz.
Okay. Thank you, Dr.
Okay. Thank you.